Good morning. I'm certainly thankful for this opportunity to be with you. I've been excited about this time that we've had together, but I realize that it's getting away from us, but that's usually the way things happen. Anytime you have a gospel meeting, you get started, and before you know it, you get to the very end of it, and it's time to go home. You have been very, very kind to us. I greatly appreciate this congregation so much. I appreciate the work that you're doing. I'm very, very grateful for the school, for the instructors. As our brother said, I'm a graduate of Southwest. I have a small part there with the school now. I have the opportunity to teach some classes. I'm very grateful for that. As I think about the schools of preaching, we're not in competition at all. We're striving to do the Lord's work. We're striving to train men to go into all the world and preach the gospel. And so I appreciate the work that you're doing in this congregation. I appreciate the school very, very much. Our theme for the gospel meeting centers around the phrase, "Let us remember." In our first lesson, we talked about the power of Christ's blood. We learn in Hebrews 9, verse 22, without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sins. God is able to take those who are dead in sin and make them alive through the blood of Jesus Christ. When we're baptized into Christ, God raises us from the deadness of sin. We then talked about the value of the Lord's church. And dear friends, the church is nothing to be ashamed of. In Mark chapter 8, verse 38, we learn that if we're ashamed of Jesus and His words, He'll be ashamed of us on that day of judgment. And then this morning, we talked about the value of evangelism. We need to remember how important evangelism is. The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and he that winneth souls is wise. This morning we're going to be talking about the importance of Christian living. And then this afternoon, after our fellowship meal, we're going to end by talking about the privilege of worship. I'm glad that you're here this morning. I'm glad that you're ready to listen to the Word of God and to challenge yourselves to grow. The Word of God will challenge us if we have a good and honest heart. If we're like Ezra, as we see in Ezra 7, verse 10, who prepared his heart to hear the law of the Lord and to do it. Well, this morning as we talk about the importance of Christian living, as you know, there are a lot of different directions that we could go with this title. That's the beauty of titles. You can go in different directions. But this morning, we're going to be talking about spiritual growth and how that relates to Christian living. And as we introduce our lesson this morning, we're going to do so by reading three different contexts. The first context comes from Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28, beginning at verse number 18. Matthew 28, beginning at verse number 18. Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, "All power is given unto me in heaven and earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost." Usually we stop right there. But as you stop and think about the Great Commission, you'll see that the Great Commission is twofold. We are to teach, verse number 19, to baptize, verse number 19. But notice the second part of the Great Commission. After a person is baptized, verse number 20, teaching them to observe all things. There is teaching before conversion. There is to be teaching after conversion, because that's how we learn how to live as New Testament Christians. If we're going to live the Christian life, we have to be taught. We have to be taught before we're baptized,
and we need to continue to be taught afterwards. As you think about the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, we learn about the life of Christ. The book of Acts teaches us how to become a Christian. But from Romans to Jude, those epistles teach us how to live as a Christian. And there's a lot of information within that that we need to know if we're going to live as New Testament Christians. And then the book of Revelation teaches us how to die as a Christian. Revelation 14, verse number 13. You think about the book of Revelation and we see this idea. If we overcome Satan, self, and sin, God says you can come over and live with me forever. That's why Christianity and Christian living is so important. We have to know how to live because heaven is a prepared place for a prepared people. Look at the second context. If you would, turn over to Romans chapter 6. Romans chapter 6. Read with me Romans chapter 6. We'll begin in verse number 3. Romans chapter 6, beginning at verse number 3. Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into His death? Therefore we are buried with Him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we should walk, here it is, in newness of life. Again, that has to do with Christian living. After one is buried in baptism, we see that God raises them from the deadness of sin, and here in Romans 6, verse 4, to walk in newness of life. That has to do with spiritual growth. Once a person becomes a Christian, once a person puts on Christ in baptism, they need to continue to follow the Lamb wheresoever He goeth. Revelation 14, verse number 4. You see, there are a lot of folks that grow up in the church, but they never grow in Christ Jesus. Think about that. They grow up in the church, but they never grow in Christ Jesus. They love Jesus on the cross, but they're like the wicked husbandmen in Luke 19, verse number 14, who said, "We will not have this man to reign over us." If we understand the importance of Christian living, of spiritual growth, we're going to make Jesus Christ the Lord of our life. Dear friends, a lack of spiritual growth is detrimental to your soul. It produces mediocrity. It produces spiritual apathy. It produces indifference. And that makes the Lord sick to His stomach. Read Revelation 3, verse number 16, concerning lukewarm Laodicea. The Lord wanted to vomit them out of His mouth because of their spirituality. There wasn't anything there. Yet they claim to be Christians. Look at this third context with me. If you would, open your Bibles to 2 Peter chapter 1. I realize as we're introducing this lesson, these contexts are familiar. But they serve the point that we're making. And they help us understand the importance of Christian living, spiritual growth. Read with me 2 Peter chapter 1, beginning at verse number 5. And besides this, giving all diligence, add to your faith. That has to do with spiritual growth. That has to do with Christian living. Add to your faith. And then Peter's going to list out several things. Add to your faith virtue, that is moral courage, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. Now listen to what Peter says. For if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things cannot see afar off, and hath forgotten that he was purged from his sins. Wherefore the rather, brethren, Give diligence to make your calling and election sure, for if you do these things, you shall never fall. When there's spiritual progress in our life, there's a sense of belonging. There's a sense of closeness. There's a sense of assurance. Again, Peter says, if these things be in you, if you're living the Christian life, if you're developing spiritually speaking, Peter says you can make your calling and election sure. I don't know about you, but I need to know that I'm going to heaven. I need to know that I'm preparing myself for heaven. And God says we can make our calling and election sure. Again, that's why spiritual growth is so important. Do you realize what we're talking about this morning was something that was on the Apostle Paul's mind as he worked with other congregations? Until Christ be formed in you, Galatians 4, verse number 19. In Ephesians 4, 17 through 20, Paul says, don't live like the Gentiles. They're alienated from God. They are even, you remember, past feeling. And then he will conclude by saying in Ephesians 4, verse number 20, if you're living like this, ye have not so learned Christ. That has to do with spiritual growth. That has to do with Christian living. It all has to do with learning more and more about Christ. In Philippians chapter 1, verses 9 through 11, it was Paul's prayer that the brethren at Philippi would grow in a knowledge of God's will so that they would discern between good and evil. But let's open our Bibles to Colossians chapter 1. We're going to camp out here for a little while. Colossians chapter 1. I love Paul's prayer. This is easy to remember. Philippians 1, 9, Colossians 1, 9. Notice Paul's prayer here in Colossians 1, verse 9. Number 9. I love this context here as it relates to Christian living, as it relates to spiritual growth, spiritual progress, because what we see in these verses is a pattern, or is a formula, a process. There it is, a process to spiritual growth. And I like processes that we see in Scripture, like Colossians chapter 1, verses 9 and 10, because it's easy to follow, it's easy to understand. What Paul says here will help me develop as a Christian. I know you're here this morning because you love the Lord. I know that you want to develop as a New Testament Christian. Here's a divine formula. Here is a divine recipe for spiritual growth. Listen to Paul's prayer beginning at verse number 9. For this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that you might be filled with the knowledge of His will and all wisdom and spiritual understanding, that ye might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. Now let's work through this process together. If we're going to develop, if we're going to grow spiritually speaking, that helps us live the Christian life, it begins, number one, with an intellectual knowledge. And I'm mentioning an intellectual knowledge for a reason. You'll see that at the very end of the lesson. But it begins with an intellectual knowledge that can only come through studying the Word of God. In Proverbs chapter 1, verse number 7, Solomon says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. In other words, if we're going to really grow in our knowledge of the Scriptures, we have to have the proper fear. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. The fear of the Lord that Solomon is talking about is that holy desire and sober reverence to please God in everything that we do. Again, a holy desire a sober reverence for our great God to please Him in everything that we do. If we have that kind of fear within our heart, we're going to grow in knowledge. You see, Solomon also talks about the soul without knowledge. In Proverbs 19, verse number 2, Solomon says, "The soul without knowledge, it's not good. It's not good for you, spiritually speaking. It will hurt you, spiritually speaking." A soul without knowledge will be a soul that does things that are contrary to the Word of God. And that's what happened to God's people. And that's why God's prophet Hosea, in Hosea chapter 4, verse 6, said this about the people: "My people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge." In Isaiah 5, verse number 13, God's people went into captivity because of a lack of knowledge. If we're going to develop as the children of God, it begins with an intellectual knowledge of the Scriptures. I grew up in the Lord's church, but I grew up in a liberal congregation. I grew up hearing fluff, no meat, no substance, and therefore we did many things contrary to the name of Jesus Christ. We lived like the world. But then I went to Shenandoah lectureships, and I heard some of the men that are in this audience this morning preach the Word of God. And I heard gospel preaching that challenged me, gospel preaching that caused me to want to investigate and to search the Scriptures. And in my mind, I was wondering, why didn't I ever hear those things growing up as a teenager? Why didn't the preacher ever challenge me in these areas? You see, when we're not preaching the whole counsel of God, we're not going to grow in a knowledge of the Scriptures. And when members of the body of Christ are not growing in the knowledge of the Scriptures, again, they're going to do things that are contrary to the will of God. You'll have members that are gambling and playing the lottery. You'll have members that are participating in social drinking, dressing immodestly. Do you realize that the Scriptures address every one of those points? And some of our congregations are downright ignorant when it comes to the subject of social drinking. That's the environment that I grew up in until I heard the Word of God. Listen to Proverbs 20, verse 1. "Wine is a mocker, and strong drink is raging. And whosoever therefore is deceived thereby is not wise." But here's the passage that did it for me. 1 Peter 5, verse 8. Peter says, "Be watchful, be sober, because the devil is like a roaring lion that's walking about seeking whom he may devour." It does us a lot of good when we search the Scriptures and we investigate in what the Word of God is saying. For example, when you look at that word sober, English word sober, Greek word, in the Greek there are different words. But this particular word, nepho, means to be free from any mind-altering substance. You ever realize that as you study God's Word, God said, God's Word never says, "Thou shalt not use LSD, snort cocaine. Thou shalt not smoke marijuana." But God's Word says, "Be sober." That covers any mind-altering substance. God wants us to be holy. God wants us to be filled with a knowledge of God's Word. Preachers, preach the whole counsel of God. I realize there are some preachers that won't even touch this subject because they are cowards. They are afraid to preach the Word of God because they think that people will be upset. They're afraid that people will leave the congregation. Again, brethren, holding back the Word of God, watering down the Word of God is not going to help people grow as New Testament Christians. If you're doing these things, you need to stop. And you need to look at the Word of God, because I promise you, God's Word has something to say on each one of these subjects and many more. Read about the works of the flesh in Galatians chapter 5. You'll see what I'm talking about. In Philippians 3, verse number 14, Paul says, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. It's hard to do that if we're ignorant of the Word of God. If we're going to develop, if we're going to grow, it begins with an intellectual knowledge of God's Word. In Jeremiah chapter 9, verse number 24, God says His people were going backwards. You continue to read the end of that chapter, and we see in Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 27 and 28, the people didn't receive correction, and listen to it, truth is perished. That's why people were going backwards and not forward. Paul says, I'm going forward. I am pressing toward the mark. Friend, if you're going to press toward the mark, you're going to have a knowledge of God's Word. You're going to have to challenge yourself to grow. And if you're going to grow, you're going to have to get hungry, spiritually speaking. There's a reason why God says that we are to hunger and thirst after righteousness. Matthew 5, verse number 6. What is your appetite toward the Word of God? Does your stomach cringe a little bit when I mention some of the things again? What is your appetite toward the Word of God? Are you truly hungering and thirsting after the Word of God? Are you like Job in Job 23, verse 12? I love God's Word more than my necessary food. Or what about the psalmist in Psalm 119, 97? Oh, how love I thy law. It's my meditation all the day long. If you really love the Word of God, you're going to have a spiritual appetite for the Word of God. As newborn babes, you'll desire the sincere milk of God's Word. 2 Peter 2, verse 2. Verse 3 also says, if so be that you have tasted that the Lord is gracious. That will give you motivation to grow. If you really appreciate what the Lord has done for you, 2 Peter 3, verse 18, you'll grow in the grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. You're going to have this spiritual appetite that will cause you to want to study the Word of God, hopefully on a daily basis. Friends, the Word of God is our spiritual food. We are to walk by faith and not by sight. But how are we going to walk by faith if we're not feeding our faith? In Romans 10, verse 17, we learn that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the Word of God. And so as we think about this divine recipe, this divine process that brings about spiritual growth, that helps us live the Christian life, go back to Colossians 1, verse 9, and you'll see the second point. It begins with an intellectual knowledge. And then Paul says we are to treat that knowledge with wisdom and spiritual understanding. In other words, you take what you're learning from the Word of God and you analyze it. You look at it. You seek to understand what God's Word is saying. You make the practical application. You just don't grow in intellectual knowledge. You got to do something with that knowledge. You treat it with wisdom and spiritual understanding. Listen to what David said in Psalm 119, beginning at verse number 59. I thought on my ways, and I turned my feet unto thy testimonies. I made haste and delay not to keep thy commandments. I love what David says in those verses, because it reminds me of the attitude that I need as a New Testament Christian. A Christian that is really concerned about his spiritual progress. And I hope you're just as concerned about your spiritual progress, your spiritual development. David says, I'm going to look at your word and I'm going to think about how I should live. I'm going to see where your word fits into my life. I'm going to think about the changes that I need to make. He didn't wait till January, by the way, to make the changes. I made haste, that sense of urgency. I made haste and delay not to keep thy commandments. David took spiritual inventory, we might say. And David allowed the word of God to confront him. And he allowed the transforming power of God's word to help him. And that's what it will do for you. That's what it will do for me. Here's another passage, 2 Corinthians 13, verse 5. Examine yourself. How do we do that? By looking into the word of God, by taking that intellectual knowledge and treating it with wisdom, spiritual understanding, asking the question, what is God saying here? What is God saying to me? You see the same idea in James 1, verse 25. We are to look into the perfect law of liberty. Some have described that context as the mirror of God's word. And I promise you, when you look into the mirror of God's word, it won't lie. You'll see exactly what God sees. And that's what Paul is wanting these Christians to do. That is what God wants us to do. He wants us to take His Word. He wants us to know His Word. He wants us to study His Word. He wants us to analyze it. He wants us to understand His will for our lives. Listen, friends, when you examine the Word of God with a good and honest heart, the Word of God will confront you. And I'm convinced that if we have the right attitude, every time we study the Word of God, we'll come away with the same conclusion. I can do better. I can do better. I can do more. Sometimes we open the Word of God, we hear lessons, we hear things like we've already mentioned, and we close the book. We don't like to hear that. We run away from what God's Word is saying. Don't run away from it, run to it. Allow it to change your life for the good. I promise you, there is power in this Word. Transforming power. If you're a Christian, you've already experienced the transforming power of God's Word in conversion. Now you need to experience the transforming power of God's Word in Christian living that comes through spiritual growth. By growing in a knowledge of the Scriptures. By examining your own life in view of what the Scriptures teach. Let's turn to another familiar context. We'll come back to Colossians. But turn with me to 2 Timothy chapter 3. And I know I'm guilty of doing this at times, just quoting 2 Timothy chapter 3, 16 and 17. That's why we're reading it together, because I'm going to make some points right here. Points that will help you, points that will help me with this great context. You're familiar with this context. 2 Timothy chapter 3, let's begin reading there in verse number 16. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. How many times have we heard those verses? But have you ever applied this process that we're talking about in Colossians 1, 9 and 10, to 2 Timothy chapter 3, 16 and 17. Work through this with me. Go back to verse number 16. All Scripture is given by the inspiration of God. Literally, God breathed. It comes from God. And then Paul says that Scripture is profitable for some things. Number one, it's profitable for doctrine. Doctrine is teaching. Doctrine teaches us how to live. Number two, we see that Scripture is profitable for reproof. Scripture not only teaches us what is right, But Scripture also teaches us what is not right. And then number three, Paul says that Scripture is profitable for correction. Scripture teaches us how to get right with God. And then Paul says, number four, Scripture is profitable for instruction in righteousness. Scripture teaches us how to stay right with God. But there's a process to that. We have to grow in a knowledge of God's Word. We then treat that knowledge with wisdom and spiritual understanding. Paul says in Ephesians 5, verse number 17, "Be not unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is." Does that describe your attitude this morning? Does it describe me this morning? God knows. God is the one that searches the heart. He knows whether or not you are striving to be the person that He wants you to be. Go back to Colossians chapter 1. Now notice with me still as we look at this process, we're to take that knowledge, we treat it with all wisdom and spiritual understanding. Now look at verse number 10, "that ye might walk worthy unto the Lord." That's the third point in this process that brings about spiritual development. To walk worthy of the Lord. That has to do with the application of what we've been learning, of what we've been studying. You see, we study God's Word, we learn God's Word, we examine ourselves, we see what God's Word is saying to us. Now, if we're going to walk worthy, we have to make the application. James would say in James 1, verse 22, "Be doers of the Word and not hearers only." Just don't sit here and hear the Word of God and do nothing about it. Because it does you no good to just hear it. You know, God's prophet Ezekiel described the people in Ezekiel chapter 33, verses 11 and 12, as the people that would come together. They would come together. They would hear the Word of God. Ezekiel 33, 31 through 32. I said verses 11 and 12, but it's 31 through 32. They would come. They would hear the Word of God. But then God says they would not do it. They would not put what they were hearing into practice. And I don't know, maybe Ezekiel is describing a lot of us this morning. We come, we hear lessons. We hear lessons on Christian living. We hear lessons on evangelism. We hear lessons on attendance. But we won't be back Sunday night. We won't be back on Wednesday night. We won't get involved in doing the Lord's work. That describes God's people. Don't allow that to describe you. God wants us to be doers. God wants us to be active. Listen, if you're not doing, we need to start doing today. Today is the day of salvation. You need to start getting involved with this congregation. By the way, the elders never approached me and said, "Hey, we want you to mention this, mention that." Brethren, these are things that we need to hear. These are things that we need to be reminded of if we're going to be faithful children of God. We have to be doers of the Word. Just hearing the Word of God isn't going to help us. I knew of a gentleman that was outside of Christ preaching the congregation there in Victoria. He was outside of Christ for years. He always attended services with his wife. He heard hundreds and hundreds of lessons and he never responded. There are people that are like that. They hear the gospel every Sunday. They hear it all of the time, but they never respond. You can see what Paul is saying in this context. If we're going to bring forth fruit unto God, we have to make application. We have to make application of God's Word. Not everyone that says to me, "Lord, Lord," shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Matthew 7, verse number 21. It's not the sayers that are going to heaven, it's the doers. It's those who make application. Those who walk worthy of the Lord. The just shall live by faith, but if any man draw back, God says, my soul shall have no pleasure in that individual. Hebrews 10, verse number 38. Let's be sure we're not drawing back. Let's be sure we're pressing forward. Let's be sure that we're heading in the right direction. And we can do that by studying God's Word, seeing how God's Word applies to us individually, and then making the application. But go back to Colossians chapter 1. Notice this next point. You see, when we make the application of the Scriptures, Paul goes on to say there in verse number 10 that you walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing. Here it is, being fruitful in every good work. That's why spiritual growth is so important. God wants us to be fruitful. Jesus said in John chapter 15, 1 through 8, here is my Father glorified. There's another process, by the way. You can say everything that we're saying this morning from the context of John chapter 15. You're clean through the Word, a purging process. But here is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit. Question, what does it mean to bear fruit? To bear fruit simply means to bring forth the product of right living. How does God want us to live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world? Titus 2, verse 12. And it's the grace of God that teaches me how to live soberly, righteously, and godly. Sometimes we don't connect that to the grace of God. The grace of God is instructive in nature. Read Titus 2, 11 and 12. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared unto all men, teaching us how to live. Teaching us to deny ungodliness and worldly lust and to live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. When I do that, I'm bearing fruit unto God. I'm fulfilling my purpose to fear God and to keep His commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. Ecclesiastes 12, verse number 13. When I'm bringing forth fruit unto God, I'm bringing forth glory unto my God. Paul asked the question in Romans chapter 6 to those who obeyed the gospel. In Romans 6 verse 21, he says, what fruit had you in those things that you are now ashamed of? He says, for the end of those things is death. Now you have been set free, you've obeyed the gospel, now you are servants of righteousness. And listen to what he says, now you have fruit unto holiness. That's what we're emphasizing this morning. God wants us to be holy, set apart from sin, set apart unto Him for His service. That's what it means to be holy. It means to bring forth the product of right living. And then very quickly, look at the last point there in verse number 10. We end with knowledge. Now remember, we started with an intellectual knowledge. When you look at this process, I don't believe Paul is talking about an intellectual knowledge here in verse number 10. He's talking about an intimate knowledge of knowing God. Do you realize what God wants more than anything from you this morning is a relationship? There are people who call themselves New Testament Christians, but they don't know God. They don't have a relationship with God. God wants us to have this intellectual knowledge, but He wants it to become an intimate knowledge of growing closer and closer to Him. Do you realize that we are as close to God as we have chosen to be? God's always there. God is ready. God has given us everything pertaining to life and godliness, 2 Peter 1, verse 3, through knowledge. And so this morning, how is your relationship with God? Do you really know the Lord? Do you really know the Lord when you are tempted? Do you really know the Lord when you face trials? Do you really know the Lord when you're discouraged? Do you realize every one of us in here will be challenged in these three areas. You can add to the list. We're all going to be tempted. Temptation is common to man. But listen, if we don't know God, when we're tempted, you know what we're going to do? We're going to blame God. You realize James addresses that? Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. God's not the source of temptation. God doesn't set us up to fail. God's pulling for us. God is working on our behalf. It is God who worketh in you both to will and to do His good pleasure, as Paul would say in the book of Philippians. Do you know the Lord when you're tempted? Listen, if you know the Lord when you're tempted, like the Lord, you'll meet every temptation with a quotation, thus saith the Lord. Thus saith the Lord. When you face the trials of this life, if you know the Lord, you know this is an opportunity for me to grow closer to God, not to run away from God. Don't resist the trials, but let the trials work in your life because it produces patience, endurance. Again, when you're discouraged, learn to lean upon the Lord like Paul did in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4. All men forsook me, but the Lord stood with me. The Lord will never abandon you. Hebrews 13, verses 5 and 6. Let your conversation be without covetousness. Be content with such things as you have, for He has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. That you may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. If you know the Lord, you're going to allow the Lord to help you. Do you see why Christian living is so important? Do you see why spiritual growth is so important? It helps us to have a relationship with God. I want you to think about your relationship this morning. Do you really know the Lord? Do you really have a relationship with the Lord? If not, I hope you have the courage this morning to respond to the Lord's invitation, not to be seen of men, but to ask the Lord for His help. To ask your brothers and sisters in Christ who love you and who want to insulate you, encourage you to do what is right. Friend, if you never obeyed the gospel, it's our prayer that you would know the Lord this morning by obeying God's plan of salvation. And by obeying God's plan of salvation, you'll be delivered from the power of darkness and you'll be translated into the kingdom of God's dear Son. Colossians 1, verse 13. A beautiful thing happens in conversion. And so if you never obeyed the gospel, we want to encourage you to make that determination this morning. Don't wait another day. We may not have another day. You realize this may be the last sermon you ever hear? If it is, I hope it will prick your heart because I'm not trying to step on your toes. That's not what I'm here for. I'm here to preach God's Word and to try to prick your heart this morning. This morning, if you need to respond to heaven's invitation, we want you to know that the Lord is ready. The Lord is here to help you. If you need His help, won't you please come right now as we stand and as we